Tammy.
How long is it? The open meeting law requires that I notify the public that this meeting is being recorded. Therefore, please be aware that an audio and visual recording of this meeting is being made and broadcast by Boston City TV, which is a part of the City of Boston Office of Cable Communications. And the first item on the agenda is authorization for approval of the minutes of March 16, 2017. Motion's in order?
So moved.
Second, all those in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Ayes have it. Item number two, request authorization to enter into a lease agreement with New Balance Robotics Corporation for the continued use of 5,836 square feet on the sixth floor of 12 Channel Street in the Raymond L. Flynn Marine Park. Dennis.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. New Balance Robotics has been a tenant at 12 Channel Street since 2014. They're in the 3D printing industry. Their lease is scheduled to expire in June of this year, 2017. We're pleased to report that we are requesting a two-year extension of the lease through May 2019. The lease rate proposed is very reasonable considering that BPDA will not expend any funds or lose a single month of cash flow, and it also represents a 50% increase over their current rent.
Okay, thank you, Dennis. Any questions from the board? Hearing none, a motion's in order?
So moved.
Second?
Second.
All's in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Ayes have it.
Thank you.
Thank you, Dennis. Item number three, request authorization to execute an architectural engineering services contract with Weston and Sampson Engineers, Inc. for the design of the parking garage addition east, phase four, in the Raymond L. Flynn Marine Park, in an amount not to exceed $2,165,000. Paul.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman, members of the board, Secretary Palemas. On September 15, 2016, the board approved the director's permission to publicly advertise a request for qualifications for selecting an architectural engineering firm to design a parking garage lateral addition to the existing 12 Dry Dock Ave parking garage. The location of the garage is on that first slide on the presentation. The objective of the RFQ was to solicit qualifications from design professionals with the lead consultant have a strong structural background with garage structures as their primary discipline. Also, it was requested to include all necessary subconsultants for providing their services of the project. The description of the project is generally that the garage addition will be constructed entirely out of precast concrete for approximately 550 cars or thereabouts. There will be two new stairwells, one elevator required by the state building code. There'll be two existing buildings that'll be demolished, and we have applied for and received from the Landmarks Commission approval to demolish those two non-historic buildings. The consultant will conduct an environmental site assessment of contaminated soil for future removal and legal disposal, and there'll be close coordination between the EPA and the Mass DEP, which my department has a very good relationship with. The new addition will match all of the existing architectural elements, and the design will include various concrete and sealant repairs to the existing garage. Oversized vehicles for the Boston Transportation Department will be dedicated for a portion of the first floor garage space. On February 1st, 2017, a completed RFQ was posted on the BPDA website, available to all interested parties. The advertisement and the solicitation was in accordance with Mass General Law Chapter 7C, Design and Selection Law. An outreach to MBEWB firms was requested from the Office of Small Business Development, and an invitation to participate was sent out to each of those certified firms. 48 firms expressed an interest in the project by downloading the RFQ on the BPDA website. Three firms submitted qualifications to the BPDA on March 9th. They are Weston & Sampson Engineers, Desmond Design Management, and WSP Parsons Brinkerhoff. The BPDA Design Selection Committee was assembled on March 10th, 2017 to review the qualifications and experience of the three firms, and an interview of the three firms was conducted on March 27th. Based upon the qualifications and the interviews, the committee recommends the contract for architectural and engineering services be awarded to Weston & Sampson Engineers of Boston, Massachusetts. Per Mass General Law Chapter 7, the design fee was set as a not-to-exceed amount of $2.3 million. After negotiation with the finalists in accordance with the Chapter 7 laws, the fee was reduced to an amount of $2,165,000. As part of the Weston Sampson team, the following MBEWB firms will provide engineering and design services to the project, and that this commitment will represent approximately 35% of the overall contract value. Tim Haas Associates, MBE, Parking Garage Design, Studio NA Architects, MBEWBE, Architectural Design, City Point Partners, WBE, Cost Estimating, Architectural Engineers Incorporated, WBE, Mechanical, Electrical, and Plumbing, Lumen Studio, WBE, Interior and Exterior Lighting, and Bryan Associates, MBE, they'll be doing the survey. Okay. So that first screen there, that shows the Raymond Elflin Marine Park, and this one here shows a little close-up version of it, showing the red area was where the existing garage is now, and to the right of that is the proposed lateral addition. Just a aerial shot showing the perspective of that location, that existing wall that you see on the left side with a precast structure, that's where we will tie into that area and go from left to right. This building right here is, it's called Building 20. That building will be demolished and to make way for the new parking garage. This is the face of where the garage will tie in. This wall right here is the start of where we'll go, so we'll go left to right. These two panels here show what the new garage will look like. This panel here, that's 13 years older than this panel here, because this is one of the additions that we put on in 2004. So the whole key in anything like this for architectural purposes, you want to be able to build a garage so it blends in nicely and it doesn't show that it's a new garage, so you have discoloration in the panels. This is a small communications building. It's called Building 40. It's on the Dry Dock Avenue side. That'll be demolished. There is some communications equipment in there, but we'll either relocate that equipment back into the parking garage itself or build a small little building to accommodate for what little space it's taking up on the site. Another perspective of the site, again, this is Building 20. Seafood representatives are in there right now, and the leasing department is working with them in order to do some type of relocation to make way for the project. This area here, another perspective of it, Building 20, same thing. This area right here is their parking lot, and the issue that I have here is we have known areas of contamination there, and basically where it came from was when the federal government, under the Defense Environmental Restoration Program, came into the industrial park. They removed various contaminated tanks throughout the site. It actually was the first year I got here. It was 1987. And this location here, you can see this is photographs that was taken in 1987. This area here is right in the middle of where our garage is going to go. 625,000 gallon fuel tanks were removed, and the problem being that the soil that was replaced to fill that void was it exceeds the limits of what can stay there. Back in 1987, the regulations allowed them to do that. So we have an RTN on it, and under our RFQ, it was all clearly spelled out what the consultant's supposed to do to go forward so that we can close out the RTN. RTN is a release tracking number by DEP. That's an aerial perspective, just to give you an idea of what it may look like for the footprint of what that'll be. The existing garage here, notice the roof deck here completely filled with cars. And then this area here will take up the area where we're considering putting that parking garage right up against it. This building right here is the 22 Dry Dock Ave BPDA office building. Just another perspective, looking at it a different way. Innovation design building here, existing parking garage here, and the proposed garage on this side fits in quite nicely. Just a Northern Avenue view from the street perspective, just to give you an idea. Didn't have enough time to make it look exactly like what we would actually have it, so the elements that are on that rendering is not what it will look like. It's just to show you an example of, in massing, what it will look like from the perspective on the Northern Avenue side. So I appreciate your hearing this, and if there's any questions that you would like me to answer, I'll be more than happy to answer those.
Okay, thank you very much. Are there any questions at this time?
I just have one quick question. So on this, is there any opportunity, and again, I'm not sure about specifics, but any kind of new technologies or innovative things people are doing with parking to help, like, with maximizing that space that we could do here just to alleviate some of the parking issues in the area?
Well, you'd have to consider, you know, do I want something that looks totally different than what I have out there now? That'd be your first question that you'd have to ask. The technology that I've read about mostly pertains to really severe congested urban parking. You know, we are fortunate with what we have here for what land space we have. I also heard that when you buy that technology, your cost per space goes up because you're paying for that. Mm. So in this case, we have an adequate space here for doing that. So this is what we felt we would go forward with, a duplicate design of what's already there.
If I could just add, relative to the opportunity to utilize new and innovative approaches to maximize the parking usage, to maximize the revenue, and hopefully have less of an environmental impact, I think that's a question that we will direct towards our new parking operator. As the board may remember, we authorized new contract with ABM effective April the 1st. They've been in place now for 12 days. So far, so good. We expect to meet with them next week to talk about exactly those types of approaches, to talk about how we use social media to better market it. But we will report back to the board once we have that plan in place.
Cool. Thank you.
Can you talk a little bit more about the tenants that are getting displaced by this project? What seafood companies is it, and what is going to happen to them?
What I know, there are two existing users in the building now. We've given them notice about what our plans are, and I know that the leasing department is actively pursuing that in order to try and find a suitable replacement for themselves.
I think you asked who the tenants were. It's Gloucester Seafood and Hook Lobster. There was two other tenants, High Quality Seafood, which has found another location, and Breadrunner Courier, that has also found a new location. Myself and Maureen in the commercial leasing department are we're meeting with them frequently. We're showing them space. We're trying to find them a place to go and be as helpful as we can in that.
Are they at the end of their lease now, or?
They're a tenant at will. The lease with us was with a company called PJ Lobster. PJ Lobster went out of business. Hook and Gloucester were subtenants of PJ Lobster. But when PJ Lobster left, you know, we allowed Hook and Gloucester to remain, because and they just pay rent directly to us in the interim until they can find a new home.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you.
Are there any further questions? Hearing none, a motion's in order.
So moved.
Second?
Second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Ayes have it. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
At this time, I'd like to invite Councilor Flaherty to.
Yeah. Thank you. Afternoon, Mr. Chairman, ladies and gentlemen of the board. I'm here to just offer support with respect to the BRA agenda number 16. An offer support for the Stavis Seafood Company and the Stavis family. They've been in Boston, down the Marine Industrial Park, now the Ray Flynn Marine Park, for over 70 years. Had suffered sort of a catastrophic event, some type of explosion at their plant, resulted in the death of one of the workers. He's currently been working out of three different facilities, and didn't lay off one person, made sure that they maintained a paycheck. Just goes to his character and his family's character, and lost a significant portion of business being in an antiquated facility. So I'm hoping that the BRA will support number 16 and give him the tools that he needs to sort of reclaim his stake in the seafood industry in the Port of Boston, and at the same time allow him to continue to create those good paying jobs for people at work in his business. So I don't see him here. He'll probably be arriving at some point. I also share the same sentiment. I just came from a meeting with Congressman Lynch, and he asked to express his sentiments as well as full support of Stavis Seafood Company, again, given their long-term status down at the park, but also anything that the community has asked of Stavis Seafood and the Stavis family, they've always stepped up to the plate. So it's our hope that they get into a new facility and they continue to do what they do best, and our hope is they'll be there for another 70 years. So just want to offer support on behalf of all the South Boston elected officials, but particularly Congressman Lynch and myself, and I know State Representative Nick Collins is en route, as possibly as well as Senator Forey as well, and Councilor Linehan. So thank you, Mr. Chairman, for taking me out of order, and thank you, ladies and gentlemen of the board. It's good to see everybody.
All right. Thanks for coming today. Appreciate it.
Good to see you.
Okay. All right, item number four. Request authorization to enter into a memorandum of understanding with the United Way of Massachusetts Bay in Merrimack Valley, LICS Boston, to help facilitate a free credit score program building. Constance.
Yes, thank you, Mr. Chairman, members of the board, and fellow staff and guests. My name is Constance Martin. I'm the Deputy Director of the Mayor's Office of Financial Empowerment, which is part of OWD. And we are working on, our mission is to help Boston residents improve their financial mobility and to learn more about things they can do to improve their financial wellness. This is a project we've been working on for almost 2 years that would be a land-breaking, very exciting initiative that would help residents throughout the city, beginning with a pilot in Roxbury, to learn how to improve their credit score and how to make progress on benefiting from the things that a good credit score provides: better mortgages, not having to put a deposit down for utilities, better apartments, being eligible for better jobs, et cetera. This is a memo of understanding that would memorialize a data sharing agreement between us and community partners so that, for example, if someone were participating, we would measure their credit score at the beginning and at the end to analyze how we improved their credit score, what techniques worked well so that we can roll this out citywide.
Okay, great, thank you. Are there any questions from the board? Hearing none, a motion's in order?
So moved.
Second?
Second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Ayes have it.
Thank you very much.
Item number five. Request authorization to enter into a 3-year service contract with DBI Waste Systems, Inc. to provide refuse removal services at the Raymond L. Flynn Marine Park in an amount not to exceed $394,190. Edward.
Good afternoon, Mr. Chairman, members of the board, Director Golden and Assistant Secretary Paul Hemus. The staff is requesting authorization for the director to enter into a service contract with DBI Waste Systems, Inc. of Everett, Massachusetts, to provide refuse removal services at the Raymond L. Flynn Marine Park. The proposed contract will be for a term of 3 years in an amount not to exceed $394,190. This advertisement was approved by the board on October the 20th, 2016. Advertisements appeared in the Boston Herald and in the State Central Register. The bid documents were also posted on the city record. Staff also reached out to the city's small and local business office and provided a copy of the advertisement and a direct link to the BPDA contracts portal. 4 competitive bids were received on March the 17th. The 4 firms and the bid amounts are included in your board package. As you can see, there was a spread between the 4 bids of only about $9,000. So based upon those results, DBI Waste Systems has emerged as the lowest responsible and eligible bidder. As such, the staff is recommending that the contract be awarded to DBI Waste Systems for a period of 3 years in an amount, again, not to exceed $394,190.
Okay, thank you, Ed. Are there any questions from the board?
Just one quick question. So I noticed in these and the other ones, did we change any of our processes and how we like outreach to different groups? I just wanted to commend that it looks like we're being really proactive with some of the other agencies to, you know, help to meet our goals for MBE type, get bids out to different groups.
One of the procedures that the director has emphasized is that we need to cast as wide a net as we possibly can. That means we reach out to the usual folks, whether it be to the Herald or to the City Register, but we also have an affirmative responsibility to reach out. We've been able to establish a very good working relationship with the mayor's office, with the Office of Local and Small Businesses. Sometimes it doesn't work as well as we would like, but we are certainly attempting to walk that extra mile and to, as I said, to cast as wide a net as we possibly can. Would you like to add something, Michelle?
Hi there, Michelle Goldberg, Budget and Procurement Management. Thank you. This is folded into our procurement efforts that we provided an update for you in the fall. And so we've been participating with the Small Business Association in the city and, trying to be a little bit more discreet and explicit about where we've been advertising. So this is all kind of part of that procurement initiative that we've been working on.
It's awesome. Congratulations. Thank you.
Okay, there's no further questions or motions in order.
So moved.
Second?
Second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? The ayes have it. Thank you, Ed. Item number 6. Request authorization to advertise and issue an invitation for bids for fire alarm services at 12 Channel Street and 22 Dry Dock Ave in the Raymond L. Flynn Marine Park. Ed.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. The staff is requesting authorization to advertise invitation for bids in order to solicit public bids under MGL Chapter 149 for contract services relating to fire alarm services within the Raymond L. Flynn Marine Park. The scope of services will include annual inspections, the testing and certification of equipment, maintenance and or upgrades, emergency response, and on-call services for the EDIC buildings within the park. It is expected that the contract will be for a 3-year term, which is estimated not to exceed $150,000 over that 3-year term. If approved, these advertisements will appear on the BPDL contract portals, on the Commonwealth's Combis online system, the Central Register, the Herald, and the City Record. In addition, once again, the staff will reach out to the city's small and local businesses to encourage bids be received by WBEs and WBEs. Accordingly, it is the staff's request that the board authorize the issuance and the advertisement of an invitation for bids to provide fire alarm contract services in the Raymond L. Flynn Marine Park.
Okay, thank you, Ed. Are there any questions from the board? Hearing none, the motion's in order.
So moved.
Second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Ayes have it. Thank you, Ed. Item number 7, personnel. Jeanette?
Hello, Jeanette Carlebell for the BPDA EDIC personnel report. Thank you, Mr. Chairman, members of the board, Madam Secretary, and Director Golden. We have a few items for your consideration on the EDIC personnel agenda. We have 2 appointments for your consideration with details listed in the board memos. Rodney Redcross, property specialist in the real estate division. Christina Rico, senior planner 1 in the planning division. We have 4 employment service contractors for your consideration with details listed in the board memos. For the Office of Financial Empowerment, Boston Tax Help Coalition, Stephanie Heidinger, Ada Pantoja, and Letitia Paterlini. For the real estate division, we have Angela Holm. We have 6 travel items for your consideration with details listed in the board memos. The travelers are Constance Martin, who works for OWD. For the planning division, we have Travis Sheehan, Colin Kersey, Sarah Meyerson, and Corey Ziegenbott, who has 2 planned trips. Lastly, we have 1 work study item for your consideration with details listed in the board memo, and that's to host a non-cost summer fellow from the Environmental Defense Fund Climate Corps to work in the planning department this coming June. Thank you.
Okay, thank you. Are there any questions on the board? Hearing none, a motion's in order.
So moved.
Second.
Second. All those in favor?
Aye.
Opposed?
Aye.
Ayes have it. Thank you, Jeanette.
Thank you.
We need a motion to adjourn the EDIC meeting.
I move we adjourn the EDIC meeting.
Second.
Second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Ayes have it. Meeting adjourned. The next item, The open meeting law requires that I notify the public that this meeting is being recorded. Therefore, please be aware that an audio and visual recording of this meeting is being made and broadcast by Boston City TV, which is a part of the City of Boston Office of Cable Communications. Item number one is request authorization for approval of the minutes of March 16, 2017. Motion's in order.
So moved.
Second.
Second. All those in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Ayes have it. Item number two. Request authorization to schedule a public hearing on May 11, 2017 at 5:30 p.m. or at a date and time to be determined by the director to consider the 1785 Columbus Ave project in Roxbury as a development impact project. Motion's in order?
So moved.
Second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Ayes have it. Item number three. Request authorization to schedule a public hearing on May 11, 2017 at 5:40 p.m. are at a date and time to be determined by the director to consider the Wentworth Institute of Technology First Institutional Master Plan Amendment to the 2010 through 2020 Institutional Master Plan. Motion's in order?
So moved.
Second?
Second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Ayes have it. Item number four. Request authorization to schedule a public hearing on May 11th, 2017 at 5:50 p.m. are at a date and time to be determined by the director to consider the Institutional Master Plan Notification Form for the Fourth Amendment to the Boston University Charles River Campus 2013 through 2023 Institutional Master Plan. Motion's in order?
So moved.
Second.
Second. All those in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Ayes have it. Thank you. I'd like to invite Representative Collins, if you'd like to, Representative, if you'd like to speak now.
Yes, please. Thank you, Mr. Chairman, members of the board. Thank you for letting me speak out of turn here today. I'm joined by my colleague in the legislature, Sean Pierce, the Chief of Staff of Senator Linda Dosina-Fori. Also would like to just say a few words in support on behalf of the senator. This project's been a long one. You know, obviously, with the tragic incident that took place, we've been all pulling to see this project get done as soon as possible. Great industry, the seafood processing industry. I know this board knows that well. A growing one and one on an asset that you guys take great care of in the Flynn Marine Park. So we wanted to just come today to support the jobs. 310 permanent jobs at this facility. It's a little over 100 now. Blue collar jobs, jobs in the city that are hard, particularly in the waterfront, to maintain. And in this area, with this investment, we're going to be able to do just that. We'll obviously get an international reputation in the seafood processing industry, and that's just going to take us a step further. 153 construction jobs with $71.6 million in private investment that we really need in our city. So I'm just coming in on behalf of myself and Senator Ford to echo the support of City Councilor Mike Flaherty and hope that you vote in the affirmative today. Thank you.
Okay, thank you. Thanks for coming. And Sean, would you like to say a few words on behalf of the senator?
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, Mr. Director, members of the board. My name is Sean Pierce, Chief of Staff to Senator Linda Dosina-Fori. I'm here to testify on the Stavis Foods project. This is a really great project. This is one the senator really believes in. You know, 310 permanent jobs for a family who has been on this waterfront for years and generations. You know, as we all know, there was a great tragedy at their facility not too long ago, but, you know, saved jobs, didn't lose a single job in the face of that. These folks are committed to the Boston waterfront, they're committed to the Flynn Marine Industrial Park, and Senator Fori would like to offer her full support, and thank you for the time.
Okay, thanks. Thanks for coming. Thank you. Item number five from the Board of Appeal. Are there any changes?
No, Mr. Chairman, no changes. There are 48 recommendations to be transmitted to the Board of Appeal for their April 25th and May 9th hearings.
Okay, are there any questions from the board? Motion's in order.
So moved.
Second.
Second. All those in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Ayes have it. Thank you, Jeff.
Thank you.
Item number six. Request authorization to adopt a map and text amendment to zoning map 7A, 7B, 7C, 7D, and Article 51, Alston-Brighton Neighborhood District, with respect to St. Gabriel's Conservation Protection Sub-District. Jeff.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, members of the board, Secretary Paul Hamis, Director Golden. Before you tonight is a text amendment and a map amendment to the Alston-Brighton Neighborhood District. It is the culmination of 4 months of community work and staff work to figure a rezoning of the old St. Gabriel's Monastery and Church site. As you're aware, the Archdiocese has been selling off properties, and on this particular location, Cabot Cabin and Forbes, as well as Avalon, are interested in developing the sites. Right now, the existing conditions for both properties have split zoning districts. The red indicating an institutional sub-district, which was done when St. Elizabeth's had the land. The green is a conservation protection sub-district. Conservation protection sub-district is zoning that we apply to land that's privately owned that has special natural or scenic features and that we can control development on. The rezoning has really come about because in the conservation protection zoning sub-district, PDAs are allowed. They are not allowed in the institutional sub-district. So Cabot Cabin and Forbes, as well as Avalon, have expressed interest in using the PDA tool to move their projects forward. And in order for a PDA to be done on the entire site, it has to be zoned for a PDA. And the map amendment will do that. It will allow a PDA to be done in the CPS sub-district. The proposed text amendment before you this evening, the CPS sub-districts establish maximum height FAR in units per acre regulations for a planned development area. The proposed amendment before you today would exempt the St. Gabriel's CPS zoning sub-district only. Reason being is because right on the front of Washington Street, if you know the area, it's a very beautiful landscaped area, a lot of trees. There's actually a burial site there for priests. And so the zoning right now would allow for clusters of 4 and 6 dwelling units per acre, depending on the size of the site. What we would want to allow happen is have the development plan govern where these buildings are in order to protect that natural feature that fronts on Washington and to also protect the church. So the text amendment would add a footnote that already exists, but it would specifically exempt the St. Gabriel CPS from the maximum regulations for a PDA. I'd be happy to answer any questions.
Okay, thank you, Jeff. Are there any questions from the board?
Yes, I'm just trying to understand and refresh my memory, please. Yep. So the difference between kind of a PDA and the normal process, or what is the difference between kind of using this tool like of a PDA, like what benefits are there, and why does this make sense to do this versus whatever the regular normal
process is? It's a great question. The PDA, we like to use it because it's more of a planning document. It's usually at the result of a planning initiative or a rezoning initiative. And it's also a way that we can memorialize certain community benefits, how big these buildings are going to be, where they're going to be located, how the parking is going to be used. And I think, honestly, it gives a lot of comfort to the community when they can read it and they can see that, yes, the grave sites for the priests are going to be protected. The church is going to be protected. The church is going, and the monastery are going to be renovated because it's based in, and it's codified and memorialized within this development plan. If you go to the Board of Appeal, there is no such document. You're just granted zoning relief.
Right. Okay.
And if there's a change to the development plan, it has to come back not only before the Zoning Commission, but before you as well. Mm-hmm. Changes at Board of Appeal, they don't.
Thank you.
Any further questions?
What is the level of public support for this change?
For the zoning change, very high. We had two public meetings. One was in December of last year, and the one most recently on March 28th out at Brighton Marine. And at the March 28th hearing, there was strong support for this amendment. Everybody is really concerned and eager to take a look at what is being proposed and how and what is being put in the development plan. And they want to make sure that everything that the developers are saying, we're protecting this, we're, you know, going to renovate the monastery and protect the church. They want to see that on paper. Right now they can't even see that because the PDA is not even allowed in that district. Mm-hmm. So support for the amendment was strong. And actually the last question when Victoria Abelina was given her presentation was, what's the next steps with this? Because everybody was comfortable with the amendment itself.
Okay. And the final PDA comes to the board for, that gets presented here, right?
It gets presented here first, public hearing, and then it has to go to the zoning commission.
Oh, okay.
Okay, are there any further questions? Hearing none, a motion's in order.
So moved.
Second, all those in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Ayes have it. Thank you, Jeff.
Thank you.
Item number seven, request authorization to accept $500,000 from the Commonwealth of Massachusetts Department of Transportation to fund the installation of a water transportation dock and associated improvements at Lovejoy Wharf, and to enter into an easement agreement with Related Beal, and to grant $500,000 to Related Beal for said improvements at Lovejoy Wharf. Richard.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, members of the board, Director Golden, and Secretary Palemis. In 2000, the City of Boston produced a water transportation plan that identified Lovejoy Wharf as the optimal location for a water transportation terminal due to its proximity to North Station, the Green Line, Orange Line, and the Freedom Trail. This is Lovejoy Wharf right here, and this is North Station. This image here is from our 2000 water transportation plan that shows various inner harbor routes that connects the city via water. The Lovejoy Wharf project site has been redeveloped and revitalized. It's now the headquarters of Converse Headquarters, and 175 residential units are nearing completion. Also, the wharf has been redeveloped into 30,000 square feet of public open space. It was once a surface parking lot. Our municipal harbor plan in Article 80 approval requires certain things from this development, including a heated waiting area, ticketing facility, but also funds to accommodate and operate ferry service. The BPDA's North Station Area Mobility Action Plan, which is nearing completion, and the South Boston Waterfront Sustainable Transportation Plan, which was completed in December of 2015, point to water transportation as a sustainable and needed form of transportation, particularly between North Station and South Boston. Right now, about 4,000 employees come through North Station and somehow get to South Boston on various forms of transportation. Probably under 15 minutes to take a ferry ride from Lovejoy Wharf to Fan Pier and elsewhere in South Boston. So it's a much more efficient form of transportation. The dock, there was a state dock at this location that was intended to accommodate this transportation, but it was repurposed out to George's Island a few years ago, and that's why we're working with the state on this grant program. So we're gonna work with MassDOT and Related Beal, the developer of Lovejoy Wharf, to construct a new dock by this fall. The dock's fully designed and permitted. This image over here shows you where it'll be located alongside Lovejoy Wharf, and there's strong interest in getting a pilot service up and running once the dock's completed this fall between Lovejoy Wharf and Fan Pier. This concludes my presentation.
Okay, thank you. Any questions from the board?
I have a question. So with the use the pilot in the fall, like
yes.
What is, can you just explain like what that pilot would be like and what?
So right now the various businesses in South Boston, Vertex and others, are paying about $6 million a year for their shuttles that run to North Station and South Station. They have a strong interest in water transportation because it's predictable that the amount of time it'll take. So those businesses are looking to at least initiate some level of service from Fan Pier to North Station. Also, we're working with Convention Center and the Seaport TMA on a transportation business plan to look at public water transportation service between Fan Pier and Lovejoy Wharf, identifying the number of ferries that we'll need, the size of the ferries, a fare structure which hasn't been identified. Mm-hmm. Originally, when we did this transportation plan in 2000, it was assumed that the MBTA was going to take on additional water transportation service, and that's not the case. So we're trying to come up with a model, a hybrid model, to run public transportation. So good things are underway, and I think this pilot will be an indication of the true demand via water transportation.
Great.
Okay, any further questions from the board? A motion's in order.
So moved.
Second. All those in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Ayes have it. Thank you, Richard. Item number eight, request authorization to re-advertise and reissue a request for proposals for the 2017 through 2018 Downtown Waterfront Vendor Services Program for trolley tour kiosks at two locations. Edward.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. The staff is seeking the board's authorization to re-advertise and reissue an RFP for the 2017 through 2018 and 2018 through 2019 downtown waterfront vending services program. That program would consist of the sale of tickets at trolley tour kiosks. All the monies gained from the vending activities in this area are reinvested in maintaining the area throughout needed improvements to the physical structure of the area, including snow and trash removal, power washing, lighting, maintenance, security, and other items. January of this year, the board voted its authorization for the advertising of an RFP for the solicitation of bids for the kiosk space located at Long Wharf and Central Wharf in the downtown waterfront district. Two responses to the RFP were received, and while the staff was prepared to recommend awards to City View Tours and Brush Hill Beantown Tours, the latter chose to withdraw their bid just before the March 17th board meeting. With that, the board approved a single award to City View Trolleys for the 2018 through 2019 seasons in the amount of $60,120 each year. Subsequently, our vendor, City View, has expressed an interest in operating the remaining kiosks and in the interest of openness and in accordance with the applicable procurement laws, council has advised that the kiosks be re-advertised. Consistent with that advice, staff therefore requests authorization to re-advertise the availability of the two remaining trolley ticket kiosks for the 2017, 2018, and 2018 and 2019 seasons, and to reissue an RFP.
Okay, thank you, Ed. Are there any questions on the board?
Going by the law, Ed, what's that push you out? When did that bid opening? Advertising and...
And to answer your question, the good news is that the RFP is done, so we can move that in a relatively short amount of time. Given the number of responses that we received, I wouldn't want to prejudge that, but I would hope to be back here perhaps as soon as the next board meeting.
Okay, any further questions? Hearing none, a motion's in order.
So moved.
Second?
Second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Ayes have it. Thank you, Ed. Item number 9. Request authorization to execute amendment number 3 to the Architectural Engineering Services contract with Bogman, Hendry, and Archetype, Inc. for design services for the necessary code and regulatory compliance improvements to the China Trade Center located at 2 Boylston Street in an amount not to exceed $62,700. Paul.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman, members of the board, Secretary Polimis. As announced by Mayor Walsh in his State of the City address in January, the Boston Public Library will be establishing a temporary branch facility at the BRA-owned China Trade Center building. To accomplish this, it was requested that the BRA and the building architects, Bogman Hendry Archetype, coordinate the design and the construction of the new library space. In order to accomplish this, it is necessary to amend the existing engineering contract with BH&A. The following design services shall be including: coordination and consultation with Boston Public Library planners, staff, and employees of the new space. Prepare public bid documents and public bidding by the capital construction staff. The new space will include approximately 1,600 square feet of library space, including seating space and a shared atrium, new flooring, lighting, bookshelves, ceiling tiles, new reading room and shared computer terminals, new children's reading room and educational programming space, visitor check-in, check-out at the front desk, new security system, new office equipment, and informational signage. Therefore, the staff recommends amending the existing engineering contract with BH&A in order to provide the additional design and construction oversight services required to complete the project. And just for your information, we are planning on coming back to the board in May to request to advertise to put the project out to bid. That'll be Chapter 149.
Okay, thank you, Paul. Are there any questions from the board? Hearing none, a motion's in order.
So moved.
Second?
Second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Ayes have it.
Thank you again.
Thank you very much. Item number 10. Request authorization to extend the tentative designation of the East Boston Community Development Corporation to facilitate the redevelopment of 148 through 172 Condor Street in East Boston. Dennis.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. In 2015, BPDA issued an RFP for the development of an 8-acre parcel on Condor Street in East Boston. The site is on the Chelsea Creek and has a strict industrial maritime development requirement imposed on it by the Commonwealth of Massachusetts. Four responses were received, and after internal and community review, East Boston Community Development Corporation was awarded tentative designation in October of 2016. They intend to develop one or two maritime industrial center for one or two buildings. The tentative designation is scheduled to expire on April 20th of this year. During the initial period, the CDC has assembled a project development team consisting of an architect, environmental professionals, engineers, and permitting consultants. They've conducted soil condition studies and development cost scenarios. They are planning to very soon bring in fill to level the site. The site really looks like a giant crater, almost like a meteor hit it right now. So there's a lot of fill required. They're prepared to start bringing that in. And they've begun negotiations with several prospective tenants. So we're requesting an extension of the designation until July of 2017 to allow the CDC to continue this site prep and solicit potential tenants and to commence lease negotiations with the BPDA.
Okay, thank you, Dennis. Any questions on the board?
This is just an extension.
Correct.
Or we're just extending. Okay.
Correct.
Never mind.
Okay. There's no further questions. A motion's in order.
So moved.
Second. All those in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Ayes have it. Thank you,
thank
Dennis.
Thank you.
Item number, the next two items are going to read and just take one vote. It's just a certificate.
I'm going to recuse myself from number 11.
Number 11, okay. Item number 11, request authorization to issue a certificate of completion to Jackson Square Partners LLC for 75 Amory Ave project. Item number 13, request authorization to issue a certificate of completion to Bridgeview Apartments Limited Partnership for the Bridgeview Apartments project. A motion's in order.
So moved.
Second.
Second.
Second. All those in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Ayes have it. Thank you. Item number 14. Request authorization to a certificate to issue a certification of approval in accordance with Article 80E, Small Project Review of the Zoning Code, for the construction of 28 rental units, including four IDP units, located at 1065 Tremont Street, Phase 2, and to recommend approval to the Board of Appeal for the necessary zoning relief and to take all related actions. John.
Good afternoon, Chairman Burke, members of the board, Secretary Polhemus. The proponents, Urban Core Development and Boston Real Estate Collaborative, filed their Article 80 application for this residential development on January 30th. A BPDA-sponsored public meeting was held on February 23rd at the Boston Police Headquarters at Schroeder Plaza. The meeting was advertised in the Bay State Banner, the Boston Sun, and the South End newspapers on February 16th. And the comment period concluded on March 10th. This project, we had a great turnout at the public meeting. The neighborhood folks there are pleased with the results of phase one, which was completed last year. So they have a good expectation about phase two. The proponents, they've established a great relationship with the St. Cyprian Church, which is across the street from the project site. The proponents have and are committed to providing significant repairs and improvements to the aging church that are valued at approximately $30,000. The 28 rental units includes four IDP units. At this time, I would like to introduce Monty French from the development team to continue the presentation. Monty?
Okay, thank you, John.
Thank you, Chairman, members of the board, and Secretary Polemus. So the second phase is very much like the first. A lot of good things were established during the first phase. The building is clad in terracotta, cement fiberboard, and it's a continuation of the same thing. The unit sizes are the same as well. Good mix of one bed, two bed, and three bed units. The only kind of departure from the first phase design is the addition of glass bays, which we feel is a dramatic improvement. The building also includes a trash management system inside, a trash chute with indoor trash management, and bike storage in the basement. And that concludes the presentation, if there's any questions.
Okay, thank you. Any questions from the board?
I do have questions. So With regard to the zoning relief that's being requested, can you give some context? I couldn't figure it out in the memo. Like, what's the magnitude of the relief that you're requesting? What, you know, describe it, and then kind of just give, like, justification, kind of why it makes sense for this project or for this area and that sort of thing.
Well, there are several zoning variances. You know, we are within the zoning height, but density we are not. Parking we are not. Area we are compliant. Width we're compliant. Non-compliant with loading. Rear yard, front yard, side yard, and open space are some of the things that we're not compliant with.
Is it a large variance? I'm just trying to gauge the size of the variances that are being asked for and kind of just understand, like, what, you know, again, just trying to put it in the context of the neighborhood of what, does that make sense with what has been planning here?
So phase one was done as an as-of-right project, so that met all the requirements. So obviously adding on phase two increases the area. So that's probably the largest zoning variance. And, you know, the other ones go along with it, the parking and things like that. Parking was provided in phase one but not used, so that's kind of taking up the parking and things like that. I don't know if that answers your question, but
yeah, maybe from a planning perspective, just get a sense. I'm not sure if this is within any of our planning study areas.
Yeah, or this is not within any of our current planning study areas, but what I can speak to, and this was already discussed, so the original phase one was done as an as-of-right project, and as the team already articulated, this is, the height is not seeking a variance. So you see here how this extension of the building essentially is staying within the context of what's there and is a continuation through a phase two. as it relates to things like parking, which they are seeking a variance, as they identified, the parking was not utilized in their phase one, and so they do believe that it would be marketable for a phase two, and we think that that's appropriate here, given that it's a core location property and could be operating with a lower parking ratio, and that's been proven out through the marketability of the project. And then it is, overall there's greater density on the site as they're filling in the rest of the site, but we feel like that also provides strong continuity of the street wall and helps to create that urban fabric and continuity. So overall, I feel like those are appropriate variances here.
Okay. And from a community perspective, can you just kind of give an overview? Were there any meetings, the community meetings, and like what was
So we had a public meeting. It was well attended. Some of the old-time residents of the neighborhood had concerns about displacement, gentrification, but this project actually didn't displace anybody. If you go back a couple of clips, Monty, so the original site had this one-story commercial space. It was just an old wood-framed structure, very underutilized site, and so the people in the community, they were just concerned that maybe they might be losing their homes, but it's really not the case. It was built strictly on the site of this former commercial space. And actually, the tax preparer office there, he moved back into the new commercial space once phase one was completed.
Oh, okay. Great.
Okay, good. Are there any further questions from the board? Hearing none, a motion's in order.
So moved.
Second. All those in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Ayes have it. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you. Item number 15. Request authorization to issue a certification of approval in accordance with Article 80 Small Project Review of the Zoning Code for the construction of 20 rental, including 3 IDP units, 2 commercial real estate, and 24 parking spaces located at 1857 through 1859 Dorchester Ave, and to recommend approval to the Board of Appeal for the necessary zoning relief and to take all related actions. John.
Thank you, Chairman Burke. The proponent of the proposed project is Conley Construction Company. They filed their Article 80 application for this mixed-use development on February 3rd. BPDA-sponsored public meeting was held on February 27th at St. Mark's Church on Dorchester Ave. The meeting was advertised in the Reporter and the Bay State Banner newspapers on February 16th. The comment period concluded on March the 10th. we had a public meeting that was well attended, and there was a robust exchange of comments, primarily regarding the parking for the proposed project. The Greater Ashmont Main Street Group, which represents the businesses, they were interested in, their preference was to see the parking ratio at 0.4. However, the people from the community, which there were a lot of, their response was that they strongly preferred to see that the parking move forward with the proposed 24 spaces, which is a ratio of 1.2. Conley Construction is also making community contributions of $5,000 to both the Martin Richard Foundation, as well as the City Youth Sports Training and Education Movement, which is a relatively new organization. These nonprofits both have within their missions of investing into youth athletics, education, and community. And recently, I was informed that the City Youth Sports and Training and Education Movement Group was visited and saw that there were an incredible amount of young people that were engaged in all kinds of different activities there. So it's great to see them doing some good work. This project, the 20 rental units, it includes 3 IDP units. And at this time, I would like to introduce Cheryl Tagayas to continue the presentation.
Okay, thank you, John.
Thank you, John. Chairman Burke, members of the board, and Secretary Palemas. I'm also joined this evening by the property owner, Steve Connolly, and counsel, Kevin Cloutier, of the law firm of Kevin Cloutier. Mr. Connolly and his family have owned this property for 20 years, where they've operated their construction and property management business from the property. They are looking to redevelop it to include a mixed use, so to have commercial space on the first floor and residential units up above, and to provide parking adequate for tenants of the building in the market conditions that they envision. The property is located just north of Peabody Square and Ashmont Station, so it's about a 10-minute walk from the T. It currently has a small, very long linear building that runs front to back, and then a large part of what's visible from Dorchester Avenue is an asphalt parking lot. So the project will replace actually a lot of impervious area with a little more green space, actually, you know, quite a bit more green space than is there now, and will create a little bit of a buffer that doesn't exist today with some of the neighbors. John highlighted some of the benefits of the project. The increase in housing with close proximity to public transit is one of the goals of the mayor. It will also produce construction jobs and then the community benefits that John outlined. So this direction would be Peabody Square and the Ashmont Station, and north this way on Dorchester Avenue. This is across street is Tillman Street. The site is really a mix of uses, so there's an auto body repair across the street, there's apartment buildings here, a large-scale residential building here, a fire station, a commercial tenant here, but then we also have a couple of single families here. So we tried to orient the mass of the building closer to the greater density and higher mass of the surrounding properties, and to leave some open space and breathing space to our residential abutters. The other thing is that currently the single story building runs right in this location. So in consultation with design staff at the BPDA, there was a request to have this building make a greater presence on the street to bring continuity to the street wall, to the urban condition here. So this floor plan has Dorchester Avenue along here. The rear abutting is the tunnel for the MBTA. And then across the tunnel would be apartment buildings. These are the two single family residential that I mentioned. Abutting here is a single story commercial. And then this is condominiums. So you can see there's a real mix of character, and this building, we think, would be a good, really, infill to what is now a little bit of a missing tooth. So the commercial space would follow along Dorchester Avenue. Parking is accessed here. There's parking here for commercial and the potential for Zipcar, and then parking for the residential is here and underneath the second floor here. This is a view, a little bit aerial, from along Dorchester Avenue. So you can see that the first floor, which now is really fronted with an asphalt parking lot, would have glass and open and visible to the street with the residential units above. A close-up of that streetscape with the access to the parking to the side. And the two commercial spaces here, and then the residential entrance right there. And this is my last slide, and I just wanted to highlight again the massing orienting itself towards Ashmont Station, which is the greater density and greater height. This is a five-story building being proposed, and it is at 61 feet. The building is 27,000 square feet on a 17,000 square foot lot, so that's an FAR of about 1.6. The ground floor commercial space is just over 1,600 square feet. As John said, there's 20 units. There are 16 two-bedroom and 4 one-bedroom units. And that concludes my presentation. I'd be happy to take questions.
Okay, thank you very much. Are there any questions from the board?
I have a few questions. We received a lot of comment letters, and there were a couple of common themes in some of the comment letters. One was about the quality of materials that you're going to use. There seemed to be an impression in the neighborhood that this team had built a building down the street that was not holding up as it should. So can you comment on that? And then there was a concern about that the construction company was going to be occupying these commercial spaces, and that wouldn't really bring any vitality to the street. It would really be more of an office space. And then another concern was the lack of three-bedroom units. So I'm wondering if you can address those issues.
I'll first address the building materials and the architecture. This project at 5 stories and 20 units allows us to, in this configuration, allows us to do a type of architecture which is consistent with that which is being built in the Ashmont area now, which has been built. So it'll be a combination of brick, storefront, metal panel, and a cementitious concrete plank type system, which has a dimensional criteria that is similar to clapboard type in terms of its dimension, but it's a much higher durable material. And then as far as the storefront in terms of the commercial uses, Mr. Connolly and his company, they service their properties that are located in the area at this location, and they do get a lot of drop-in activity, and it is their intent to be able to be available to the tenants of their properties in the similar way that they are now. But if it is possible for them to consolidate their operations into a smaller space and rent out the other space to a retail use, they're definitely willing to look at that. And the three bedrooms, that was not, thank you. That is not something that was, I think, raised at our meetings. The two-bedroom mix is something that the Connollys are comfortable with in terms of having rental properties in the area and understanding the market and thinking that this is going to meet a need in the market. But if Mr. Connolly has any further observations or comments about the three-bedroom, I think that would, okay.
Okay, any further questions?
Just one question. Again, back, just coming back to the zoning, description of the zoning variances requested. So again, just trying to get my arms around the magnitude of the zoning variances, and then from a planning perspective, I'm not sure if this falls into anything, but kind of why does whatever variances kind of make sense for this area?
So I mentioned the way we oriented the massing. So we are on the property line towards the south, which is our abutting property is also on the property line. So rather than have a setback that leaves a narrow space in between the two buildings, in our conversations with BPDA design staff, Michael Canizzo in particular, there was agreement that having the mass oriented on that property line and then turning as an L was more desirable from a urban design point of view, but it did trigger a setback violation. And then in terms of density in the FAR, you know, with the proximity to the T station, that density of 1.0 is a bit out of date with the desires to increase our density closer to the public transit. So we felt as if the five stories was a good balance between the underlying zoning and what the goals of increasing the housing units are in the area. And then on the parking, the parking is a combination because more parking is required under the zoning. And as you heard and you've commented on, there's been some who've asked for less parking. There also have been those, as John said, who asked for the one-to-one. They feel as if there's pressure on the surrounding streets because people can park there and walk to the T. And so they felt it was important for this site to be able to accommodate all of its own users. So there is a violation on the parking because 1.5 is what's required under the zoning. And I think those are, and then the open space, as I said, we are providing more green space than exists now, which is zero. We are providing balconies as well. But there is a violation on the open space.
So, Jonathan Greeley, Director of Development Review. Vice Chairman Rojas, Chairwoman Rojas, I think a lot of what Sarah, thematically, a lot of what Sarah said for the last item applies here. And I'll just extrapolate a little bit more. So, first, we have lots of zoning exercises happening all over the city. But it's a big city and a lot of stuff going on. So the way we treat every single project, and I think Cheryl's comments illustrates that, is every proposal is every development proposal is a planning exercise in and of itself. So we're making decisions and suggestions and reactions to the proposals that while ultimately might trigger a height variance, we feel is beneficial for the site and the project itself. So that conversation happens here every single day. And I think the overall goal is to contextualize. I think you see in terms of, for example, the density, there are some other tall buildings in the area. You're responding to the lower scale buildings with some open space. So you're having the conversation all the time. And the interesting thing about zoning is that even recent zoning captures a moment in time. And so we're always trying to find a way to make sure contextualizing is the best project for the site. In terms of the parking, I think is a good point. This is actually, we're trying to balance here. And I think John and I talked about this a little bit today. We thought we might get some questions on this. There was a robust discussion during this process. There's an active Main Street groups in the area. There's also a lot of residents. TOD means different things in different parts of the city, right? I live downtown. It's a walkable place. It's very easy not to own a car. Dorchester near a transit stop, there is great access to downtown, but also there's a likelihood you might need a car too. And so I think this is a good mix of TOD while keeping the ratio lower, but also making sure we do have some parking that met the community desire. And what I think I like about this is that it's surface parking. So as in the future, as we see car use becoming less and less, it doesn't preclude active reuse of that surface parking to something else, right? And so I think we've found a good balance here of a lot of different issues.
Awesome.
Okay, are there any further questions on the board? Hearing none, a motion's in order. Second.
Second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? The ayes have it. Thank you very much. Item number 16. Request authorization to issue a determination pursuant to section 80A-6 of the zoning code in connection with the second notice of project change for the construction of 201,000 gross square foot seafood processing facility, including marine warehousing and accessory office space located on the portion of parcel M1 in the Raymond L. Flynn Marine Park, and to take all related actions. Gary.
Good afternoon, Mr. Chairman, Director Golden, Madam Secretary, and members of the board. This project was
is an old project. On June 22nd, 2007, the Marine Terminal Operator LLC, the original proponents, filed a project notification form which called for the construction of a approximately 500,000 square foot of development on 29.8 acres. Since then, there has been two notice of project changes, second of which is what we're here today to discuss. On November 15th, 2016, the new proponents filed a second notice of project change, which initiated a 30-day comment period. As described, it is a 201,000 square foot seafood processing, marine warehousing, and accessories marine support office building on a 130,000 square foot footprint. On the 5th of January, there was a public meeting held at 22 Dry Dock in the Marine in the Ray Flynn Marine Industrial Park. And on January 3rd, 2017, there was a approval by the Boston Civic Design Commission for the design. At this time, I'd like to invite Mary Fleming to further the presentation. Thank you.
Okay, thank you, Gary.
Good afternoon. My name's Mary Fleming, and I am one of the four owners of Stava Seafoods. We've been in business since 1929, and we've been in Boston for many, many years. When I started a few years ago, we were at 148 Northern Ave, which is now a bar and restaurant, next to Paul's Lobster at the time. We moved up to the industrial park in 1984 and fitted out the shell of the 7 Channel Street facility. When we moved up there, there were 18 employees, and we're now up to 135 employees. As far as facilities, we grew out of the 7 Channel Street facility, and about 2003 we moved our offices to the Fish Pier so we could expand the 7 Channel Street facility. And then, and I believe it was 14, we added an additional space at 310 Northern Ave to do some fresh processing. We reached out to Cargo Ventures, Millennium Partners, because of their experience and their capacity, because our overall goal has always been to be under one roof, to be able to do all of the things that we do under one roof and in a state-of-the-art facility. And in the city of Boston, it's a challenge sometimes to find that as a standing building. So I'll turn it over to Jake Citrin to further explain.
Okay, thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you, Mary. Chairman Burke, Director Golden, I'm Secretary, members of the board, I'm Jacob Citrin, and on behalf of the project team, Cargo Ventures, and Millennium Partners, I'd like to express how delighted we are to have partnered with Stava Seafoods on this significant project. When Mary and Richard Stavis reached out to us several years ago, we immediately knew the significance and complexities of bringing this project to fruition. And while we believe we are almost uniquely qualified to undertake this development, given our prior industrial development experience in Boston, we have to acknowledge the tremendous support of the mayor's office, the South Boston delegation, the staff of the BPDA, and the Massachusetts Port Authority in helping to bring us here today. This is a very exciting project, and I would like to introduce Brian Fairbanks, the project architect with Parsons Brinkerhoff, who will walk us through the details. Thank you.
Okay, thank you.
Good evening. I just would like to give a brief overview of the project and the site itself. This slide, I think, more pertains to the BPDA things. Specifically, this picture is of the Massport Marine Terminal, and the showing in yellow highlighting the parcel 5 itself. The next slide, this is an aerial locus of the marine terminal area. So in the kind of the top portion of it, you'll see the parcel 5 itself, and it shows the relation to the existing channel 7 Channel Street facility to the southwest. These are a couple of existing photos of the existing Stavis facility at 7 Channel Street. Here is the proposed site plan. As mentioned previously, it's a 130,000 square foot footprint with a little over 200,000 total square feet. It is a proposed one- and two-story building. The two-story portions are office above the warehouse and industrial facilities below. All of the vehicular access will be off of Fid Kennedy at the intersection of Tide Street. The site itself is proposing 165 parking spaces, which happens in two different parking areas. There's a 60-space parking area to the north of the site along the harbor, and there's 105 parking spaces that are adjacent to Fid Kennedy Ave. Let me see if I can get the pointer to work. So the entrance to the Stavis facility is here on the north facade, and the proposed entrance to the future tenant building is here on the southern facade, and there will also be emergency access and egress along the western side of the property. The eastern side of the property is going to be where the truck and loading operations occur, and again, that will all be off of the intersection of Fid Kennedy and Tide Street, which is runs right along here between parcel 5 and parcel 6. This slide here just shows a comparison of the previously proposed project, which I believe was in the magnitude of like 500,000 square feet. This is a much smaller proposal. It also is much less land. It doesn't take up the entire marine terminal like the previous version did. Here are some contextual photos of the area. Just I'm sure probably everyone's aware of what this area looks like, but on the top left slide, the top left slide is that's Fid Kennedy as you're looking east along the site frontage. The top right is Fid Kennedy as you're looking west along the site frontage. And the bottom two photos are the access road looking both east and west that are on the northern part of the site as you're adjacent to the harbor. These are a few precedent photos that were taken just to show the existing buildings in the area. The top two slides show the existing Legal Seafoods, and the bottom two show the existing Harbor Seafood Center that is directly to the west of the Parcel 5 project. Here is a rendering of the proposed future tenant building. This would be the southeast facade, well, the southern facade and the eastern facade. This is what you would see as you're driving on Fid Kennedy and approaching the site. As you can see, the truck docks and the loading area on the east, and on the south side is the main building entrance to the future tenant side, where there would be a lobby and elevator corridor. The next slide, this shows the view from the north. This would basically be what you would see if you were on a boat in the harbor coming by the site. So a lot of the architectural focus was put on this side of the building as the view from the harbor. This portion of the building has the horizontal metal panel. Working with Dave Carlson and the BCDC, we've added this large logo to the corner of the building to help really let the Stavis logo be seen. Hopefully, as you'll see with the two building entrances, there are canopies over the two kind of main entrances. The north facade is sort of the main building entrance to the Stavis, and this eastern entrance is it can be for employees, but also can be for people coming in for the fish sales. And also it shows the smaller 60 parking space parking lot that's to the north. These are the elevations. As you'll see again, the north and the south elevation, that's where a lot of the color and the different materials were brought in to really highlight those two facades, what you would see from Fid Kennedy and what you would see from the harbor. These are the east and west elevations, which are, again, the focus was really put more on the two ends of the site that are going to be most seen by abutters and by people traveling on the harbor. And as far as the presentation goes, that's it.
Thank you very much.
Yep.
Are there any questions from the board at this time?
I just have one question. Are there any Chapter 91 implications for this site or this project? Or
so So the site does fall within, Sarah Meyerson, Director of Planning. The site does fall within our master plan for the Marine Park. And so we expect that all of the uses here will be consistent with that, which is ultimately guided by Chapter 91. And so that really, here on the site, what that really means is dictating that the uses here will be considered marine industrial uses. I think we're excited to see that these are marine industrial uses, both one that's staying in the park and then a future tenant that could be relocating to the park and continuing with the mission overall of having those industrial uses that are particularly needed along the water. So that this is consistent overall with both the existing master plan and then the future master plan as it's currently in draft form and available for public comment.
Thank you. And just out of curiosity, when you said like where people could come in for the fish sales, is that like restaurants? Is that, can I go? No, I don't mean that. Like,
it is not a restaurant. It is basically a cash and carry. So it is smaller restaurants come in to purchase wholesale fish for their facilities.
Cool.
Good. Are there any further questions? Hearing none, a motion's in order.
So moved.
Second. All those in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Ayes have it. Thank you. Congratulations.
Congratulations.
Thank you. Item number 17. Request authorization to enter into an amended and restated affordable rental housing agreement for the 61 through 83 Braintree Street residential project. Tim.
Chairman Burke, Vice Chair Rojas, members of the board, Director Golden, and Secretary Palimas, I come to you today to ask for your approval of an amendment to the Affordable Rental Housing Agreement and restriction for 61 to 83 Braintree Street in Alston. This 80-unit rental project with 11 IDP units sits immediately adjacent to the Mass Turnpike and was approved by the BRA Board on February 13, 2014. As you can see the location, the reason why there's a change is because there's actually a large billboard that's also at the site. And when they, after approval, it was determined by the Boston Civic Design Commission and BPDA staff that the relationship to the new building and the existing billboard would be problematic. After a change in the building's massing, IDP unit locations also need to be shifted. And this change in unit locations required this amendment today.
Okay, thank you, Tim. Are there any questions from the board? Hearing none, a motion's in order.
So moved.
Second.
Second. All those in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Ayes have it. Thank you. Item number 18 has been removed. Item number 19, request authorization to execute an amended to the land disposition agreement with South Station Phase 1 owner LLC to extend the outside conveyance date and at the end of the conversion conditions period, and an amendment to the development agreement to extend the outside closing date, both in connection with the South Station Air Rights Project. Gary.
Thank you. Good afternoon, Mr. Chairman, Director Golden, Madam Secretary, members of the board. This board recently voted in support of the notice of project change on December 15th of last year. And the land disposition agreement, as amended, has currently an outside conveyance date of April 30th, 2017, and the adverse conditions period, which expires also on April 30th, 2017. The development agreement by and between the developer, the MBTA, and the BRA has an outside closing date of April 30th as well. At the request of the development team, and in an effort to facilitate the construction of the approved project, staff is before you today to request authorization to execute an amendment to the land disposition agreement and amendment to the development agreement to extend such dates until December 30th, 2017. We have David Perry from the development team, should there be any specific questions.
Okay, thank you, Gary. Are there any questions from the board?
I have one question. So this is just to extend the dates. Have any of the project elements changed, or this is just it's just a date thing?
Just the dates.
Okay.
There's no further questions. A motion's in order.
So moved.
Second.
Second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Ayes have it. Thank you.
Thank you.
Item number 20, over in Charlestown. requests authorization to adopt a minor modification and to execute an amended and restated land disposition agreement for parcel R97, located at 305 Main Street. Allison.
Good afternoon, Chairman Burke, Director Golden, Madam Secretary, and members of the board. Before you is a recommendation for approval authorizing the director to adopt a resolution to allow for a minor modification and to enter into an amended and restated land disposition agreement allowing for the construction of a three-unit townhouse condominium located at 305 Main Street, parcel R97 in the Charlestown Urban Renewal Area, project number Mass R-55.
Thank you. Are there any questions on the board? Hearing none, a motion's in order.
So moved.
Second.
Second, all those in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Ayes have it. Thank you, Allison. Item number 21, requests authorization to amend the 2015 cooperation agreement with Northeastern University to reflect the student housing commitments. Gerald.
Good afternoon. Mr. Chairman, Director Golden, Secretary Palimas, members of the board. In 2013, we approved an institutional master plan for Northeastern University with the commitment from them that they would build or cause to be built, meaning perhaps with a development partner, a minimum of 600 beds for undergraduate students within 5 years of that approval. That commitment is memorialized in the cooperation agreement connected with that IMP. You'll remember that about a year ago, we approved a project being built by a development partner, American Campus Communities, on a piece of land owned by Northeastern. It's an arrangement that we haven't seen yet in Boston. Northeastern, previously with the Grandmark, had also teamed up with a development partner to build a 720-bed dormitory. But in that case, they master leased the building. In this case, ACC will not only own but operate the building. And so while there are some agreements between Northeastern and ACC about referring undergraduates to the building, we wanted to ensure that that commitment, which when we wrote it in the cooperation agreement, we didn't anticipate this kind of arrangement. We thought it would be a more traditional arrangement where Northeastern would build a dorm or maybe master lease a dorm. We want to ensure that we have the ability to enforce that commitment. So although we don't realistically anticipate that the occupancy by Northeastern undergraduates will drop even anywhere close to 600, much less below 600 undergraduate students, given the location of the dorm, given that it will be publicized to Northeastern students by the university, we want to ensure that we are able to enforce that commitment. So what we're proposing is a modification to the cooperation agreement, and I've put some of the key provisions there as they've currently been negotiated with Northeastern. The language is not completely finalized. That would allow us to do that and monitor and enforce the provision in a way that reflects the existing reality of the building and the ownership and management structure.
Okay, thank you, Gerald. Any questions from the board?
Gerald, sorry.
No, go ahead.
In the event, let's hypothetically say that the consequences need to be triggered, what exactly would be the consequences for Northeastern, there not being enough Northeastern students in the building?
Right. So we've effectively preserved the same recourse that we had written into the original cooperation agreement, which gives us wide leeway to take action. It could be denying them a certification of consistency or compliance for a building that they'd like to pull permits for. It could mean denying them the right to file for a new project. So in some cases, those could be quite severe actions that we could take, but we have a lot of discretion to determine exactly what action could be taken. I don't expect that we will ever be in that situation, but we have a lot of recourse if, in fact, after multiple failures to ensure that occupancy is what it's supposed to be, and multiple meetings with us over the term of the IMP, they continue to fail to meet that occupancy target.
Thank you.
Just a quick question. Whose job within like our team does that fall under as far as like monitoring this or like how you?
So all universities in Boston already submit annual reports to the city under the University Accountability Ordinance. This building does not technically need to be reported by Northeastern because of the language in the ordinance, but every other dormitory that they operate would be reported on, and they do need to report at least by zip code all of the residence locations of all of their enrolled students. So we're going to ask that they include this at the building or address level with their report that they already submit, and that will go to DND as well as to myself and anybody involved in institutional development on this end, so that we can on an annual basis make sure that we're seeing the occupancy of the building and monitoring it.
Okay, thank you.
There's no further questions. A motion is in order.
So moved.
Second. All those in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Ayes have it.
Thank you.
Thank you, Joe. Item number 22. Request authorization to expend $44,515 from the Prudential Center Community Benefits Fund to 10 community-based organizations and to enter into a grant agreement with each organization. Brian.
Good evening, Chairman Burke, members of the board, Director Golden, Madam Secretary. In July 2014, the BRA board approved the flagship retail renovation project in the Prudential Center in the Back Bay neighborhood of Boston. As part of this project, the developer contributed $44,515 to be used for community benefit funding in the adjacent neighborhoods. In January of 2017, the Boston Planning and Development Agency released an application where organizations could apply for up to $44,515 in community benefit funding using the agency's newly piloted community benefit application. Historically, the process for dispersing community benefit funding has been cumbersome and unpredictable. To help standardize this system, the BPDA, in partnership with the Mayor's Office of Workforce Development, created an application that allows organizations to request funding in a more open and transparent manner. This new and innovative approach allows applicants to submit a detailed budget and comprehensive plan for how the money is to be used. Working with local elected officials and the Mayor's Office, we alerted various community organizations about the availability of these funds throughout the community benefit application process. The board's vote tonight will allow staff to issue these funds and enter into grant agreements with 10 community-based organizations. Thank you.
Okay, thank you, Brian. Any questions from the board? Motion's in order.
So moved.
Second.
Second. All those in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Ayes have it. Thank you.
Thank you.
Item number 23, the compliance update. Peter.
Good afternoon, Chairman Burke, members of the BPDA board, Director Golden, and Madam Secretary. Thank you for giving me this opportunity to share with you our BPDA compliance unit review of 2016 and our goals for 2017. This presentation is about housing compliance. We will be coming back to you to share our IDP annual report at a later meeting, which will give you greater detail about the numbers and demographics of our units. I will also share with you another area of compliance that I monitor, and that is the Boston residents' jobs policy at another board meeting. This short presentation is about the BPDA housing compliance unit. Every month, you probably leave the board and say to yourselves, we just approved a lot of developments that contain some IDP units. I bet you think on the way home, I just hope somebody is monitoring these units that we have approved. This presentation is aimed at letting you know what we do in compliance, what tools we use, and some of our progress, so that you could rest well knowing that your approvals are monitored effectively. So this is a short presentation. So it starts, what does housing compliance do? It starts with your approval, and then the housing policy manager, development review, and legal review, what you have approved. And then the initial implementation, the housing policy manager with legal and Office of Fair Housing does a marketing plan. And they're the ones who do the lottery, organize the lottery. and then it comes to us, the initial income and asset certifications for housing compliance, and then the ongoing compliance review, housing compliance, owner occupancy, enforcement, annual rental reports, and rental audits. And with me today is Tim Davis, who is the housing policy manager, and Mary Lou Mendonca, who works on all the rentals for our properties. So our general program statistics are, since 2000, 1735 IDP units have been completed. 229 of these units were completed in 2016. So by tenure, 577 are home ownership units and 1,158 are rental units. And given that there are four people monitoring these, they each have about 434 units that they are monitoring per person. These are our general statistics. As you see, all IDP units are created by private market. There are ups and downs in the completions in line with changes in the market, as can be seen before and after the recession. While the 2016 numbers are lower than the record-setting numbers of 2015, some of this can be linked to the substantial number of projects approved as we emerge fully from the recession and future production appears healthy. These are some general program statistics. Significant new production is underway. 746 units are permitted or in construction, and 656 units have BPDA approvals. Our compliance activity for 2016, 492 reviews of income and assets, 69 condos, 423 rentals, 30 resale requests, and 33 refinances and subordination. We review the income and assets for applicants with properties with a BPDA income restriction. In addition, when a condominium is being sold, the seller must contact us through a resale request in order to determine what the maximum resale price can be. So this is just a general description of our staffing. I am the compliance director. Tim is the housing program manager. We have a senior housing compliance manager, an affordable housing portfolio manager, a compliance analyst, a housing compliance assistant. We usually have two interns that work with us, and additional staff is the great work from the senior counsel and her staff, and development financial manager, and also for other guidance outside legal counsel. So our 2016 successes, new methods for tracking owner occupancy. We used to send out a letter every year that we would want an assigned affidavit and two utility bills, but we used a system from LexisNexis called Accurint, where we could trace where mail is being delivered, so it helps us more accurate determine if somebody is living there or not living there, which is really important. Because one thing I want to convey to you, we have a great program. We support it totally, and we really feel anybody who violates it, we will go to the fullest extent to change their ways. I want you to be with increased enforcement. So far in 2017, we've already had 15 resale packages. Mary Lou has done a great job sending out letters to people that we feel may be in violation of the covenants, and we've got a great response from that. The rental owners, you know, we have a lot of turnover at the management companies, so we have ongoing training. We have started doing audits of rental properties, meaning that coming in, give us the files so that we could see to make sure they're accurate. And using development review of new products to increase compliance, Tim has been excellent working with the project managers at the beginning of a project so we could talk over the covenants as we move on. So for some of our successes, we've had Salesforce, which is the new pipeline. One thing that I'm really proud of is we have a housing assistance phone line, meaning that on our website, all the calls used to go into Mary Lou's desk and interrupt her appropriately during the day for any questions. We now have a designated phone line that somebody could call in if they have any questions. There's a script, which if you're looking for lottery, call Fair Housing. Management issues, call your management company. If not, leave your number. We call them back within 24 hours. I usually get between 4 or 5 calls a day. It used to go to the front desk to Kate, so it really frees up her, and it really is appropriate that it comes to us, and the people are so grateful that they get a call back. It really is refreshing, and they have, a multitude of questions. We've improved our website. We have updated documentation, our affidavits. We work more closely with development review at the front end, working more closely with Fair Housing and Disability Commission on anything, if there's ADA issues, and we move the artist certification to the arts and culture area. So some goals for 2017 are continue implementation of the Salesforce data cleanup, which is taking a lot of work. Also, the Salesforce was implemented really for project management. We'd like to get another dimension of it for our housing world, that we could send out letters to people. DND has the program, but financially we are making requests for it, that we have an upgrade with it. That'll come in the future. One thing I'm starting to implement is a hearing process that we, on our laps every day, we make decisions of people's housing. And sometimes they have an issue. And it's not really, if they're over asset, that's one thing. If they have trust funds, that's another thing. Some things are clear. But some things like, we think you're not living in this place, but you're saying you are, we're going to invite people in to talk to them, to say, give us some evidence and work with us on this. So that's new, and it's going to be our legal counsel, myself, and a representative from the Department of Neighborhood Development are going to start these. And I think it'll be a great service to our people in our units. We're finalizing our document updates, Fair Housing, updating the marketing process, and improve consumer experience in the future. Work with DND to rebuild the metro list. And also in FY18, we have a goal to create a one-stop application portal that somebody could, go into this portal and find out any housing in the city of Boston. And that's it.
Okay, thank you, Peter.
Thank you.
Good job.
Thank you.
It was a lot of information. We appreciate that.
What's the metro list? What's metro list?
Yeah.
The metro list is an existing program that used to live in Fair Housing. It was, for all intents and purposes, owners of traditional subsidized affordable housing are required on turnover to submit information on the availability to metro list. In the past, it was very run as almost a paper operation, where they would literally fax something into MetroList, and then they would fax out copies to CDCs and housing search organizations, et cetera. So what is changing now is an attempt to make this, it is now part of the Office of Housing Stability at DND, and its intent is to create an online system whereby managers can input information as things become available, and it's also easier for the consumer to find that information online.
Any further questions?
Thank you, Peter, for your presentation. I have just two general questions. On page 6, where you talk about the 2016 compliance activity that has taken place, in general, are you gathering most of your data from developers and property managers, or are you gathering, are most of your interactions directly with the residents of the units themselves? I'm curious where your most of your information is coming from.
From the numbers?
Yeah, just in general, where you're getting your information about the people in the units. Are you getting it from them themselves, or are you getting it from the developers and property managers?
You mean the income?
Yeah, any kind of information
yes,
you're trying, when you're trying to look at compliance.
Yeah, the applications go to the management companies, and they then come to us for review. So that's where we get the information from.
Great. And how do you decide what units to review? You said you did 492 reviews. How do you decide which units to review in any given year?
Mary Lou is our expert on review.
Okay.
So that's the number of new applications, of applications for people seeking apartments or houses for the first time. That's how many were reviewed. We seek to get annual reports from all rental developments on all of the people in their units.
So every year, every unit is sent, the property manager, developer sending you guys a report about that unit and who's
yes.
in it. Okay.
Ideally.
Just trying to understand where you get your information. Thank you.
Okay, great. There's any further questions? No. Well, thank you very much.
Yeah.
We appreciate
thank you.
That.
Mm-hmm.
Thank you. It's good to have this every year, actually.
Yeah, I like the one-stop application
on.
Portal.
Yes.
That FY, like, what's the timing on that?
This is Tim Davis again. That's still to be determined. That's going to be a very large project
yeah.
that it will be involving the Department of Neighborhood Development and possibly the Boston Housing Authority. What the step we were already taking is we are having regular meetings to create a single application so that we're all asking the same questions and having at least one form so we can take that step now. Our goal is to, we're hoping to follow the model set by New York City. There's a program they call NYC Connect that is a portal, and they have been able to establish it in part because of the size of the city, but it's in a substantial cost, and we're looking at how we would be able to fund that and make that happen.
Mm-hmm. Okay, thank you. Thanks, guys. All right, the next item is the second quarter budget update, and I just want to remind everyone that in about 10 minutes we have to do the
tape change
for the TV, and then also we have to be out here by 10 o'clock tonight.
Never going to live that down, Mr. Chairman.
So. Chris, take it away.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. My name is Chris Giuliani. I'm a director of
Mr.
Finance.
Mr. Chairman, I have a lot of questions on the budget.
A lot of questions.
Hopefully the presentation is so good
so
that
many.
You won't have it. Good evening, Mr. Chairman. My name is Chris Giuliani, director of Finance, members of the board, Secretary Paul Hamas, Director Golden. It's my pleasure to be here this evening before you to present a budget update on the second quarter of fiscal 2017. My brief presentation tonight will cover an update on the actual versus budgeted operating expenditures, operating revenues and expenses for the first half of the fiscal year through December 31st, 2016. In addition, I will briefly discuss actual capital expenditures versus budget for the first three quarters of the fiscal year through March 31st, 2017. And last, I'll provide an update on the agency's current cash position and projection through the end of fiscal 2019. Thanks, Michelle. For the operating budget overall, we are tracking very closely to the budget on expenses and performing much better than expected on revenue. The latter, as you'll see in the last slide of my presentation, has helped improve our cash position versus our projection when we presented the budget back in July. Revenues are tracking budget closely in most categories except for the large positive variance occurring in the rental and leases category, where EDIC received a one-time cash payment related to the sale of the lease at 27 Dry Dock. This payment was originally projected to occur after the first quarter of 2018, but came almost a year early, about 9-10 months early. Smaller and offsetting variances appear in equity participation and project income. Equity participation in revenues can be the result of fluctuation or seasonality in the real estate market,
and project income includes some one-time revenue from the sale of air rights. Expenses are also, oh, I'm sorry, Michelle. Expenses are also tracking closely to budget in most categories, with the largest variances occurring in personnel and property management. Personnel is running almost 6% ahead of budget, due mostly to something I described in the first quarter update, which is just a budgeting oddity of us posting stipends for youth opportunity unlimited workers in the personnel line when actually they're budgeted in the contractual services line. We'll fix that for FY18, but we just keep noting it as it goes. Also in the personnel line, there are some one-time payments of accrued time to recent retirees. As of early January, about the time of this data, our headcount was close to our budget estimate of 252, including posted vacancies. As of the last week, our headcount by the same measure has dropped to 247 due to higher than expected attrition and slower hiring of our remaining posted vacancies. The variance in property management is the result of timing and seasonality in actual spending versus a smooth budget benchmark. We expect actual spending to catch up and possibly exceed the budget by year end. On capital spending.
See the budget by a lot, or
just? No, I don't think it's going to be a lot. I think it's our benchmarks aren't completely lined up yet with the seasonality. That's something we need to work on with more historical data. But judging by what's out there and the contracts that we know are going through, I don't think that we're going to be much over, but it'll catch up for sure. Capital spending through the third quarter, as you can see by the chart, if you can see that, it's a little bit small, it is only 45% of the budget thus far through three quarters. And it's due to slower than budgeted spending on China trade tenant improvements and broker fees at only 31% of what was expected. We also have slower than expected spending in the Raymond L. Flynn Marine Park related to broker fees on parcels A, N, and Q1 and elevator repairs at 12 Channel and the parking garage at only 50% spent thus far. So with so few months left in the fiscal year, it's unlikely that spending will catch up fully with the budget on capital. So we'll likely have a surplus there. Okay, Michelle.
And then what happens with the surplus? We don't have to get that back to anybody, right? That we keep that and that's.
No, I mean, if it were city money that we didn't spend, which we usually try to spend that as fast as we possibly can, usually that they've been a little tighter on that and saying that you've got to get through it in the year, but we've had just a recent meeting with the city on the money they've given us this year, and they're going to give us more time to spend the rest of that money. Our money just goes back into our pocket, and we will spend it as we go forward.
Okay.
The next slide, Michelle. So this is a slide that I presented to you back in July when we were projecting the upcoming year. And you remember it was we described a cash crunch. It was just a timing issue, really, where we had a lot of capital expenditures expected to come out of our cash early on in the fiscal year, and we were expecting the large payment from the sale of the 27 dry dock lease later in the year. Since then, I think I mentioned in the first quarter update, things have changed, so I've redone the chart so you can take a look at it. Michelle, thanks. Oh, and just remember, at that time, we were talking to you about securing a line of credit, possibly, if we needed it. So this chart shows the change resulting from the earlier than expected one-time 27 dry dock payment and delay of China trade and other capital expenses, along with other positive variables, which like a better cash position at the end of FY16. What's really great about this chart is that it shows you our projections for a structurally balanced budget. You can see the green line of revenue is over top of the red line of expenses. So projecting going forward, we think that we're in a balanced position when it comes to recurring revenue and recurring expenses. And that allows us to add to our cash balance. We're staying above our recommended minimum cash balance, which is the straight gray line there of about $6 million where we'd like to stay. And modest spending of cash on currently planned and additional capital needs is the dark green columns. But going forward, as we document cost out and schedule our known capital needs and think about the possibility of emergency projects with the amount of property that we own,
You know, we expect significant pressure on our resources going forward related to capital than what's presented here. This is a conservative going forward look. So that's all I have. If there's any questions, I'm happy to take them.
It looks better.
Much better situation, Madam Treasurer.
Yeah, well, thank you, Chris. That was a
awesome.
Very good report.
Good.
Are there any
good. Thank you.
Questions from the
thank
board?
Thank you, Chris and Michelle. Thank you.
Much better.
Are there any questions or comments from the board?
Nice. That's great.
No?
Okay.
Thank you very much. Good job.
Thank you.
Thank you. So we have to take our recess now to change the tape, so we're going to take a 5-minute recess, and we'll be right back. Thank you. Okay, we're going to bring the meeting back to order, and it'll be item number 24, contract. We need a motion to pay the bills.
I move that we pay the bills.
Second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Ayes have it. Item number 26, personnel. Chris.
Good evening, Mr. Chairman. Glad to be back. We have a few items for you this evening on for your consideration on the BRA personnel agenda. I have five travel items for your consideration with all the details in the board memos. Trin Nguyen, OWD, John Tad Reed, and David Carlson from the Planning Division, Carolyn Bennett from MIS, and Brian Golden from the Director's Office.
Okay, thank you. A motion is in order?
So moved.
Second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Ayes have it. Thank you very much, Chris.
Thank you.
Item number 27, the Director's Update. Director Golden, do you have anything?
I have a couple things. Thank you, Mr. Chairman, and through you to the members. First of all, I'd like to apprise the board of an open meeting law complaint and the status of this agency's response to it. On March 31st, 2017, the agency received notice that an open meeting law complaint had been filed against the agency alleging that the BPDA, the Boston Planning and Development Agency, violated the open meeting law during its proceedings for the approval of the Plan JP Rock study area. I believe that each of you have received an email with the open meeting law complaint attached. The Commonwealth of Massachusetts Office of the Attorney General and the Massachusetts Code of Regulations 940 CMR 29 sets forth certain requirements for a public body to respond to an open meeting law complaint. One such requirement is for the public body to delegate responsibility for responding to the complaint to counsel and must first meet to do so. Upon authorization for the general counsel to respond to the complaint, the general counsel will assemble all appropriate documents and materials, answer the allegations, and make recommendations for any remedial actions and respond in writing to the complainants and the Attorney General for the Commonwealth of Massachusetts. Our attorneys are reviewing the matter and preparing an answer to the complaint. At our next board meeting, we plan to bring the matter formally for you to authorize the BPDA's general counsel to respond to the complaint and file an answer with the Massachusetts Office of the Attorney General. So more on that next month. I also just want quickly to acknowledge the excellent work you heard tonight from Peter Sasso, Mary Lou Mendonca, and Tim Davis in our compliance division, particularly with regard to housing. They do an extremely important and effective job at bringing our compliance with regard to the affordable housing portfolio into the modern era. They use hard work and modern responsible business practices to get the job done that best serves the inhabitants, those eligible for the affordable units, ensuring that the right people are in those units who satisfy the criteria that our policy requires, and in doing so they provide a tremendous service not just to the individuals who are fortunate enough to live in those units, but to all the people of Boston, given the value that we all place on effective and meaningful affordable housing programs. So thank you, Peter, Mary Lou, and Tim. Chris Giuliani provided us with a budget update. The one thing I want to reiterate that Chris did an effective job at tonight is this is a positive picture. I got here in 2009, 10, 11, very difficult budget years for the agency. We're operating in the black, and that's a wonderful thing. That's a good thing. What always must qualify that reality is the understanding that we own significant property, and that's how we generate our operating revenues. We own an ancient bit of maritime history, the Charlestown Navy Yard, and while that's a lovely residential community for the most part, there's significant old infrastructure dating back over 100 over 150 years ago. And that requires significant maintenance, and much of that maintenance has been deferred in recent years. So there's an insatiable appetite for capital improvements at the Navy Yard. The same is true over at Raeflin Marine Park. Again, it's an aging Army-Navy base that we took over in the 1970s. The infrastructure maintenance costs that have been deferred there are colossal, and those properties will consume revenue for as far as we can see. But we are grateful that we are on an even keel, and that our revenue allows us to make the investments that are absolutely necessary in those properties. In the past couple of weeks, we've had a lot of activity out in the neighborhoods. On March 30th, in response to a request from Representative Dan Ryan of Charlestown, myself and a whole lot of BPDA staff went over to Charlestown to talk about Article 80 and sort of sound planning concepts. There's a lot of activity in most neighborhoods with regard to Article 80, but it's rare that we ever have been over there to just talk about Article 80 independent of a development proposal. So we wanted, and we're going to do a series of these through the neighborhoods, explain to people, try as best we can to stay away from getting bogged down in a conversation about a specific project, talk about Article 80, what it means from soup to nuts, from the application by a developer to ultimate disposition by the board, with a special emphasis on the points along the road through the Article 80 process where the public has a real significant opportunity to be heard. And so we highlighted the opportunities to weigh in. And several dozen people attended. It gave way not just to a presentation by agency staff, but to a vibrant conversation. There were probably very few people there who didn't have an opportunity to ask a clarifying question. So by and large, it was an excellent visit to the neighborhood of Charlestown to help drill down on some of the nuances of Article 80 and how to use it to give meaningful voice to residents of the neighborhood. On April 3rd, our research division released Boston's Creative Economy. I believe the copies were provided to board members. This document is an update to a 2005 report, also entitled Boston's Creative Economy. It assesses the size, scope, and economic impact of creative industries in the Boston of 2017. This follow-up that was released in recent days describes how the size and composition of employment in Boston's creative economy has changed over the last decade. Monday, we went down to the City Council for our second biannual City Council update on our urban renewal efforts. As you know, we made a lot of commitments to the City Council during our process in which we sought extension of our urban renewals, urban renewal areas. The extension was granted by the Commonwealth after a City Council vote last summer, but we committed to go down twice a year to let the City Council know what we're up to as far as fulfilling the commitments we made through an action plan. So we went down, we spoke about our urban renewal plans, land disposition agreements, special attention to the South End, the Central Business District and South Station, North Station and Government Center. I just want to say, and I think this is important to highlight the people who worked on this, because it tells you how much effort is going into this. I think, frankly, it's a lot more than we anticipated to fulfill these commitments, to look anew at our urban renewal powers and how they've been used in the neighborhoods. It's requiring a lot of staff time. It's the right thing to do. We need to give this our full attention, given the fact that a lot of things the agency should have been tracking over the past 60 years of its life, it was not doing a very effective job tracking. So we're making up for that now, but it's costing a significant amount of money and a significant amount of staff time. So I just want to point out who's working on this. Alec Bonelli, Joe Rose Bordeaux, Eileen Brophy, Janet Carlson, Mike Christopher, Tim Davis, Tammy Donovan, Ruth Adele, Jaime Figuera, Sonal Gandhi, Kristen Cara, Renee Lefebvre, Daniel Johnston, Kathleen Joyce, Diana Meyer, Sean Nehill, Allison Quinn, Hugo Solis, Nate Smith, Mallory Toomey, Emily Ouija, Corey Zengabot, and Ala Zick. There's a lot of people. Some of them doing it full-time. A lot of them are doing it part-time. But it's taking up a lot of the agency's attention. But again, we're righting a ship, and these efforts are completely worthwhile. I'm not going to get into depth on the shadow legislation, but as you may know, we filed a home rule petition on Monday that seeks legislative relief, both here and the City Council. And ultimately, if we're successful with the home rule petition being voted out favorably by the Boston City Council, it moves up to the state legislature, where we seek to have relief granted from the existing state shadow law that would permit the shadow to be cast by the Winthrop Square Garage. Again, our arguments, to oversimplify perhaps, is $153 million at stake that will benefit the people of Boston, not just in the downtown area at all, but in our parks, in affordable housing efforts in East Boston, affordable housing efforts in South Boston. And this project is a once-in-a-generation opportunity to address some really significant human needs in this city. We think we're making a responsible proposal that allows a potential project to be permitted and built, not prejudging an outcome. The Winthrop Square Garage project is still moving through the Article 80 process, but nothing over 400 feet can be built without any relief from the shadow legislation. So we've filed that. And another important piece, not just the cost benefits of the economics, we are trading through this law, we are trading some shadow that could be cast by future projects. Right now, there is a certain amount of shadow permitted under the state law. We're trading some of that is permitted in the law for the shadow that will be cast by the Winthrop Square Garage. So we're trading a certain amount of shadow for a certain amount of shadow. And we're trading shadow that could be cast midday for shadow that disappears early in the morning. It's important for all interested parties to understand that the shadow at the Winthrop Square garage that would be generated by the project there disappears by 9:30 in the morning, and its average duration during the calendar year is 36 minutes. So those are the facts of the matter, and we're going to continue to share our perspective with the Boston City Council and the state legislature. So finally, yesterday, the day before, I went over to our Office of Financial Empowerment's tax preparation service that we provide over at 7 Palmer Street in Roxbury. So for 16 years, the Office of Workforce Development, ROWD, which is, as you know, part of the Boston Planning and Development Agency, has worked with the Boston Tax Help Coalition, a public-private partnership of over 30 organizations operated through the Mayor's Office of Financial Empowerment. It provides free tax preparation and comprehensive asset building services to low and moderate income residents in Boston. The overwhelming profile of most people who seek this service is incomes below $30,000. But last year, and I think we're on track for similar numbers this year, last year we provided free tax return preparation service to 13,000 primarily low-income Bostonians. And with a couple days to go in the tax filing season, looks like we'll have similar numbers to that. So this is a really important service. It makes a real difference in people's lives to have tax preparation professionals sit with them at no cost and help them navigate the sometimes very complicated area of federal and state taxes. So it was a wonderful visit. I went over there. There were a whole lot of people queued up, last-minute filers, but we're going to get them serviced and processed before the deadlines early next week. And people were downright happy. Even though they're waiting in line, they know they're getting a tremendous value without cost. And it was a wonderful thing to see them receiving services, primarily some from our staff, but primarily from volunteers. So just one of these niche functions that this organization helps provide to the people of Boston that makes a real difference in their lives. So with that, thank you very much and have a good evening.
Okay. Thank you very much. Brian, any questions from the board? No questions, okay. I guess we need a motion to adjourn.
I move we adjourn this meeting.
Second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Meeting adjourned.
They're not. They're valuable. They're a valuable resource in our city. They're people.
I was like a little kid not knowing where to go, and they helped me out a lot. And I've been here for 15 years, and now, you know, I got my kids. I got my, you know, my girl. Everybody trusts. My whole family trusts me. You know, and now, if it wasn't for this place, I don't know where I'd be.